Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Storm Power by D.N. Hoxa, narrated by Elise Arsenault. Chapter 1. We never made it to Detroit. Wanna guess why? "Take a left, Luca," Fallon shouted, and the next second, we all slammed into the side of the minivan. Elisa's hand slipped from mine. We were on the road for barely 3 minutes when Luca had to change course. Half an hour later, we were still being chased by four SUVs. Luca was doing the best he could to get away. Good thing it was the middle of the night, probably, and the roads were more or less free of traffic. I thought about surrendering for a whole minute. We were being chased by the ECU. There was no way they weren't going to chase us to the edge of the world if they had to. They were not going to let us get away. But then, I thought about Eric Adams and Melinda, even Sylvester Kane, and decided I'd rather die on the road fighting than go back in that basement and let them cuff me to a fucking bed. So, here we were, wounded, tired, barely able to hold our own weight, but we were ready for a fight just as soon as they caught us. Or we ran out of gas. Either could happen at any second.
"If we stop now, we might have a chance. There's only four cars," Grover said, breathing heavily.
He stood on his knees in between the front seats, holding onto them with both arms, looking out the windshield. I was thankful for it. He was blocking our view.
"Backup is coming," Axe said, shaking his head.
We had a few weapons, but they weren't going to help us. And our magic, like I said, we were exhausted. After what happened at the ECU research facility in Inwood, I thought they were going to need a bit more time to regroup. We'd brought the demons inside their home. Well, I'd brought the demons inside their home, and I'd done it all with a single kiss. They'd killed everyone they could kill and left the rest unconscious. But the ECU was nothing if not quick to jump to action, and we were witnessing that firsthand. The dragon was still around my hand. Just half an hour ago, it had turned into this huge sword made of lightning, able to cut through demons and kill them on the spot, by the looks of it. Now, it seemed like nothing fancier than a cheap plastic bracelet you could have gotten at the thrift store. The plan was to use it again when the ECU caught up with us. I was really hoping it wouldn't come to it, though. Whatever this thing really was, I was getting it off my hand as soon as I could. "What the?" My heart jumped when Elisa suddenly raised her head, her eyes open wide, looking around the minivan. She pushed me to the side with all her strength and rose to her knees, hitting the top of her head to the roof. She was disoriented, terrified, both reasonable. Me? I was smiling. "It's okay. You're okay. We got you out of the ECU," I said in a rush. "Is she awake?" Fallon called from the passenger seat.
"We need help," Axe said without missing a beat. "The ECU is after us. If we don't make them back off, they're going to catch us."
And Elisa could make them back off. She was a hedge witch. It was nighttime. Most importantly, she had spells. I thought she'd want more explanation, but one look back at Grover, she pushed him to the side and took his place in between the front seats. Hope sprung in my chest. With spells, there was a very small chance we could actually get away from the ECU. A very small chance, but a chance nonetheless. That is, if Elisa was willing to help.
"Where are we?" she asked, her voice low.
She didn't bother to wait for the answer before she started chanting. It gave me some much-needed energy, too. I got to my knees and dragged myself closer to the front of the minivan.
"The Bronx," Luca said.
"What can you do? We can open the back doors if you need to." The SUVs were right behind us, easily accessible for spells. We could protect us from their bullets while Elisa unleashed her magic.
"I'm too weak for that," Elisa said with a flinch.
"Luca,
I need you to take a right here, then the first left. When you see the highest building around here, stop in front of it.
We can't stop, Axe said. Backup is probably on their way.
Can't you do a healing spell on yourself? If you confuse them or something, we'll be able to slip away.
It sounded simple enough. All we needed was 1 minute, and we'd be far away.
I can't, Elisa whispered, and when she turned to face me, I noticed the blood dripping from her nose.
Shit. She looked sick.
It's fine, I said, as Luca cussed and hit the steering wheel with his fists. Try a healing spell. You're bleeding.
If she passed out again, we'd be in even deeper shit.
What's in the building? Fallon asked. Where are you taking us?
The Twin Parks, Elisa whispered, and my blood turned to stone for a second.
Are you out of your mind? Said Grover, terrified even more than before.
Just listen to me, Elisa started, but Fallon didn't let her finish. You want to take us to the only place that's probably worse than the ECU?
Turn the car around, Luca, said Grover. But I couldn't let that happen. Don't turn the car around. Take us to the Twin Parks.
The Twin Parks was also known as the Lair to the paranormal community. Or a part of it was. It's where practically all of the vampires of New York hung out at some point in the night. Direct sun rays killed them, literally turned them to ash. So the night was the only time they walked out of wherever they slept in the summer. In winter, they had more room to navigate on really cloudy days. But even then, they became very weak when walking outside. The lair was their hideout, a place they'd claimed for themselves, where they partied all night and did whatever vampires do when they get together. I really didn't want to know. But Elisa wasn't a vampire. If she wanted us to go to the lair, chances were she had a reason.
Scarlet, Axe warned.
I know a guy there. He's going to let us in, Elisa said, wiping the blood from her nose. She looked even worse now than before. Her legs gave up on her, and she fell on her ass. The ECU won't dare go in there.
They're vampires, Fallon shouted.
Are you sure they'll let us in? I asked Elisa. The guys were right. We were heading into the vampire's lair. Not a smart idea, but what if it could save us for another day?
I'm sure.
Maybe it was the paranoia, but Elisa didn't sound very sure.
What if the ECU get in anyway?
Axe asked.
They won't.
They never have before, Elisa said, then fell on the bed of the minivan on her back. I rushed to her side and helped wipe the blood coming out of her nose even faster now.
Do a healing spell, Elisa. Do it.
I didn't care if she had energy or not. She needed to heal right now.
This could backfire, Luca whispered. They could kill us instead.
Fuck. Go for it, Fallon said. I'll take my chances with some bloodsuckers over power suckers any day.
Same here.
When Luca turned left, I rose to my knees again and prepared. The dragon was still just a dragon around my wrist and not a sword of lightning. The first bullet hit the back doors of the minivan and made all of us jump back. Axe raised his hands at the doors to keep them from opening, but we couldn't hurt the soldiers like that. We couldn't even see them. Kick the doors, I said to him, raising my own hands. My magic was still weak, my whole body shaking. I was pretty sure I wasn't going to be able to hold any kind of shield for long, but damn if I wouldn't try.
Turn it on, Grover shouted, nodding at the dragon.
We're here,
Luca called, and hit the brakes so fast he slammed us all onto the front seats. The front doors opened, and he and Fallon ran out. The gunshots began then, and they lasted for a very long time. Grover jumped between the seats and got out of the car, too. Axe grabbed Elisa by the hands and pulled her up. I helped him get her over, but she was so weak.
She'd let go of her body completely, and her eyes were barely open, her face and hair completely bloodied. "Put up your shield," I said to Axe when he jumped on the driver's seat to help Elisa get out. Wind blew inside the minivan once more, pushing my hair back. The gunshots didn't stop. Not until I jumped over and finally saw the huge building behind the windshield and the vampires standing in front of it. "Elisa," I said, slapping her cheeks. "Elisa, look. It's the vampires. We're here." But her head fell limply to the side of the seat. The others were trying to fight off the ECU soldiers, and if I wasn't mistaken, the gunshots had slowed down a bit.
"Noah,"
Elisa whispered. I wasn't sure I heard her correctly, but before I could ask, something fell to the side of the car, hard. It was Luca, his body completely limp when he hit the ground. No time to think. "Noah!" I shouted at the top of my voice, looking at the vampires through the windshield. "Noah!" Whoever this guy was, he was our last chance. Even if we somehow managed to get these soldiers off us, others would come, and they weren't going to stop. Unless the vamps stopped them. "Come on, come on, come on." The crowd of vampires watching us slowly parted, and a bear of a man stepped forward. His green-dyed hair shone bright under the moonlight. I sat in the driver's seat to show him Elisa sitting next to me, and I hoped with all my heart that he'd recognize her, that he'd want to help her. I held my breath and waited. And when another body landed on the ground, I didn't dare turn to see who it was. The soldiers were closing in on us. I could feel it. "Turn on," I shouted at the dragon on my hand. "Please, turn on." Squeezing my eyes shut, I imagined the sword made of lightning in my hand, able to cut through anything, even steel cuffs. I didn't want to go down without a fight, and I had no energy left in my body to hold my magic even for a minute. But when I opened my eyes again, the dragon was still just a dragon. "Stupid, stupid thing," I shouted, so frustrated I didn't even notice that all the vampires had started to walk forward until they were all around the car, blocking the streetlights. The passenger door moved, and my magic hurried to my hands until I saw a head full of green hair. It was Noah. His wide, dark eyes took me in for just a second. That's when I realized that the gunshots had stopped. The sound of footsteps filled my head. It sounded like a freaking army. Noah put his hands under Elise's body and took her in his arms. On shaking legs, I got out of the car only to see at least 100 vampires just walking toward the back of the minivan.
"Let's go,"
Axe said, grabbing my arm. The sound of a soldier calling for order and telling the vampires to stand down vaguely reached my ears, but I turned my focus to Axe and Grover, who was walking with Luca's arm wrapped around his shoulders and Fallon right behind. They were following Noah into the building ahead, and we were the only ones to walk in the opposite direction. Vampires watched us, some with hunger reflecting in their eyes, some with curiosity. We held our heads down and followed the head full of green hair, quickly disappearing inside the building. Turning to look at the ECU soldiers would just scare me even more than being inside the lair, the actual freaking lair. With so many vampires around, I couldn't even count. So, I kept my eyes on my feet, and I didn't stop until Axe, Fallon, Grover, and Luca did. Chapter 2 Noah took Elisa into an elevator, and we followed. Neither spoke a single word, but the tension grew in the closed space. The room he took us to was small and dirty, but it had a bed, and that's where Noah put Elisa. It was easy to guess what their relationship was when he wiped the blood off her face with the sleeve of his shirt, then kissed her on the mouth. Elisa's eyes opened for just a second, then closed again. Noah turned to us, his hands on his hips. He analyzed us, and he took his sweet time to do it, too.
Who are you?
He looked young and was built like a werewolf, but the features of his face were soft, and the green hair wasn't something I expected on someone who sounded so old.
Elise's friends, Lucas said, clearing his throat. She saved us a couple weeks ago, and the ECU took her. Tonight, we got her out.
Noah flinched and turned to look at Elisa.
The ECU had her? They had all of us, said Axe. Thank you for letting us in.
Luca took a step forward and offered the man his hand. Noah stared at him for a long time before he shook it.
Thank you for getting her out. What day is it?
Luca asked.
Thursday,
the guy said. Thursday. It felt like I hadn't met Thursday in a long time.
Guys, we need to leave, Fallon whispered.
Can you heal her? I asked the vampire, nodding at Elisa. We weren't going anywhere without her.
I can't, Noah said.
Don't know why I asked. He was a vampire. They didn't even carry around spellstones because they didn't have enough magic to activate them.
But you do need to leave.
He nodded at the window to our side, covered in old newspapers, so I hadn't even noticed it. With my heart in my throat, I walked to it and tore a piece to look outside.
They're only going to hold them back for so long.
They were a flipping huge number of vampires. They had the whole neighborhood locked down. If it wasn't for the minivan and the four SUVs in the middle, I wouldn't have been able to even see the soldiers, speaking to some of the vampires, waving at the building. Shit, he was right. Elisa is coming with us, I said, and turned to walk back to the bed. But when I did, I found Noah right in front of me. God damn the super speed. I hadn't even heard him step behind me.
Elisa stays with me, he said.
He was a head and a half taller than me, and I could only imagine what his fists could do to my face. Fighting him was not something I wanted to do right now. We need her. She needs us. If she stays here, they'll find her.
She stays here, Noah said again.
Where the hell are we going to go now? Grover said, panicked. Do you have a car we can borrow? Or steal?
How long do you think we have?
Luca asked, and moved to the window to see for himself.
5 minutes? Probably less,
Noah said, his eyes still on me. She's safer with us, I said. But I was pretty sure he could smell that I was lying. Elisa wasn't safer with us. She was safer far away from us. But we were safer with her, and right now, we could really use some safe.
He spit, very angrily, but he was cut off. You need to separate.
All eyes in the room turned toward the bed. Elisa had woken up, and she was dragging herself to sit up. In a blink of the eye, Noah appeared by her side.
Hey,
he whispered, his voice completely transformed.
How are you feeling?
I'm fine. We need to go, and you need to separate, she said to us. The longer you stay together, the faster they'll find you.
We can't separate, Lucas said, a dumbfounded smile on his face.
You have to. Trust me, the more of you together, the easier you are to find.
We're in no condition to go solo, Grover said. We have no energy, no weapons, and nowhere to go.
He's right, I said reluctantly. Elisa, we need your help. If we step out there on our own, even if the ECU doesn't find us, they will. By they, I meant the demons, and she knew it very well. As if she just realized it, Elisa flinched. How did you manage to get out of there in the first place? The others turned to look at me. Hyper aware of the dragon around my bloody hand, I put my arm behind my back. Long story. One I wasn't very keen on sharing.
I didn't know they had you. I thought you...
Noah said. Then his voice trailed off when he realized we could hear him. Take us home, Noah, Elisa said. Surprise registered on his face.
Home? With them?
Please, Elisa said with a nod. If we don't leave now, they'll catch us. I don't want to go back. The fear in her eyes was unmistakable. Whatever the ECU had done to her, I was willing to bet it was similar to what they'd done to us. I glanced back at Luca, who was still looking out the window, and his pale face said it all.
We have to move.
The soldiers were on their way. Noah said nothing else. He grabbed Elisa in his arms again and walked out of the room. My screaming muscles and overtired brain seemed to feed my fear and paranoia with every step we took. I spent more time looking behind me than ahead, and each time I turned my head, I expected one of two things to happen. An ECU soldier to shoot at me, and I no longer had the energy to even protect myself from bullets, or a vampire would decide that just because we were with Noah didn't mean we weren't fair game, and sink his fangs in us until we were drained of blood. Noah took us down the emergency stairs, as if we needed to be tested even more. It wasn't just me. Luca, Fallon, Grover, even Axe were swaying from one side to the other every few steps. We were at our limits, and if we didn't stop soon, we were going to fall and not be able to get back up. It was a while before we did. Noah sent us through an apartment and out its window, which led us to a rooftop. The darkness enveloped everything around us, and we had to hold hands to make sure we wouldn't fall. Thankfully, Noah wasn't using his super speed. If he did, he'd have disappeared a long time ago. But I suspected he was sparing Elisa, who was still wrapped up in his arms, hiding her face under his chin. After the rooftop, we had to jump a foot down to the ground. My feet screamed in protest, but I ignored them. We're almost there, I said to myself, though I had no idea if we were in the lair any longer. Nobody around us as we entered what looked like a park with only one of the five lampposts working, spewing dim light across the seven half-broken benches and the ground. It didn't smell unusual, just asphalt and garbage, until he led us into the trees. I couldn't tell you what kind they were, how big or how dense. I just held onto Grover's arm and pushed my legs forward. The smell of spells made my stomach growl. It was too much, but I had no thoughts to spare on worrying if we were getting into trouble. Finally, what felt like an eternity later, we saw a house. It was well-built and brand-new-looking, with maroon walls and three large windows in the front. It looked nothing out of the ordinary, if you discounted the fact that it was in the middle of a park. And when my head got the chance to catch up, I realized we hadn't walked an eternity to get to that place. We'd walked for 5 minutes, maybe six. Elisa, they're right behind us, I said, though it could have been the fear speaking. We need to get farther away. It would be so easy for the ECU to find us or the vampires if they decided they wanted snacks before sunrise. We're safe here, she said, and tapped Noah on the shoulder. He immediately put her down. Nobody's ever found us in here yet. She looked better, her eyes more alert, and she seemed very sure when she turned and walked to the door, which Noah was already holding open for her. I wanted to believe her. I really did. But lately, every time I thought things were going to be okay, that's when everything went to shit. But the others didn't ask questions. With their heads down, they dragged their feet behind Elisa until I was the only one left outside. My ears searched for any sound, but other than insects buzzing in the night, I heard nothing. This place was spelled heavily, that much was obvious. But would the spells hold against the ECU now that they knew we were in the area? Only time would tell. Sucking in a deep breath, I walked inside the house. The living room was more homey than I'd have thought. Lots of colors. too much color all around us, starting with a rainbow rug by the entrance. Pictures of Noah and Elisa were everywhere, in frames, glued to the kitchen walls. Noah looked like a different man in them, and so did Elisa. They both looked very happy, smiling widely in each picture. For a girl who spewed hedge magic spells like she was 100 years old, Elisa's tastes sure surprised me.
Thank you, Luca said when Noah closed the door behind me.
He finally felt safe. I still didn't.
You need to sleep, Elisa said, walking over to the kitchen and the coffee machine on the small counter.
And when you wake up, you need to separate. There isn't much time, and I won't risk my home for long.
Nobody is going to separate, Axe said, reading my mind. We're stronger together, and we need to be strong now more than ever.
I'm tired, she whispered, pouring herself a mug of coffee, while Noah stood right beside her, always searching her face as if he were expecting something to happen. He didn't try to hide his affection, either. Elisa apparently meant a great deal to him.
Elisa, we were being held in the ECU together with you. There were others there as well. The demons, they
took them.
They took all those people and probably tied them to walls to suck their magic whenever they pleased. Those witches had no chance if we didn't help them. None.
I'm sorry, Scarlet, she whispered and met my eyes, holding on tightly to her mug.
This is as far as I can take you. Now, sleep.
Don't, I shouted before the words had even left her lips. She was chanting again, the same spells she put on us while we were in her car. She was putting us to sleep against our will. By some miracle, I was able to run toward her, even jump over the small coffee table. A punch on her face, just a small one, was going to stop her. But before that happened, Noah stopped me. He materialized in front of me just as my feet touched the floor again and put his hands on my shoulders. My magic tried to break free, but there was no energy in me to push it forward. Elisa's voice was the only thing I could hear. The words of her hedge spells so strange. Something settled around my shoulders, pushing against the top of my head, burying me deeper until my lids were too heavy to hold open. The sound of bodies falling to the ground scared me, but Noah wouldn't let me move. My legs gave up on me, and the world disappeared to leave place for another, much darker and more sinister. I'd have liked to rest since Elisa was making me sleep anyway, but they didn't let me. The demons, the green-eyed man, my father. They chased me down the rabbit hole, their laughter mocking me. Run, little witch, run, they said. And the worst part? I remembered it all. Their faces, the feeling of being chased when I couldn't get my body to move fast enough, the feeling of almost getting caught by any and all of them, and the desperation of dooming all those witches to a fate worse than being imprisoned by the ECU. When my eyes opened, it still felt like I had the whole world at my back, just waiting to devour me, to swallow me whole. It was a long night, or day, and though no immediate pain in my body caught my attention, I was still tired, my eyelids heavy. Remembering how I'd gotten into that strange room, sleeping in a bed wrapped in bright pink sheets, wasn't necessary. Elisa was in front of the door, holding her hips, looking at me like she was disappointed. I sat up way too fast, and the view went dark in front of my eyes for a second. We were all alone in the room, though it was obvious that somebody had slept on the floor and the other twin bed across from mine. There were blankets and pillows everywhere, and it smelled of sleep, too. The pink lamps around the room were turned off, sun streaming through the two round windows between the beds. I still wore the white shirt and pants of the ECU, though both now dirty and bloody. I casually raised my arm to smell myself. Shoot. First door on the left, Elisa said. It looked like I hadn't smelled my underarms as casually as I'd thought.
You have clothes in there, too. Don't take too long.
She turned around and left before I could remember to speak. Normally, I liked to take my time in the shower, but that day, I was in and out in 5 minutes. The clothes Elisa had given me fit, but tightly. The jeans were a size too small, hanging lower on my hips than I'd have liked, and the dark green shirt looked cropped on me. I didn't check the mirror for bruises, afraid of what I might see, and I ignored the dragon bracelet around my hand the whole time. Just pretend it isn't there, I said to myself whenever the panic began to set in. I would pretend for as long as it took to find out how to get the thing off me. The others were in Elise's living room. They were pretending, too, to watch TV. Noah was nowhere to be seen, probably because of the sunlight. The sink was full of dirty dishes, which meant the others had eaten. When Elisa saw me coming in, she pushed a bowl at me. Cereal. Great. Thanks, I whispered, and dug in before my stomach had the chance to start screaming at me. The others stood up from Elise's green and blue couches and came to us, leaning over the counter to the side of the cabinets. Elisa looked down at the floor as if she couldn't wait for us to be gone. I guess I could understand her. Swallowing the honey-flavored cereal, I cleared my throat. Let's get right to the point. We're screwed, probably even more than we realize right now, and we need help. Desperately. What you need is to separate, Elisa said. I shook my head. We're not going to do that. Then you might as well go turn yourselves back in, she said with a shrug.
Okay. Let's back up for a second. Why were you in the ECU in the first place? Why did they take you?
Luca said, but he wasn't asking the right questions. Because. Elisa raised her brows at him. Elisa, the demons have the others. We're not sure exactly how many, but they have them, and they're probably feeding off them as we speak. We need to help them.
No,
she shouted. Forget it. I was in there too.
And we got you out, Fallon spit.
You did, and thank you for that, but I'm not going back in.
Couldn't say I blamed her.
We're not either. You hunt the demons, don't you? For whatever reason, you know how they work, where they hang out. Otherwise, she'd have never found the ones who caught us and took us into that abandoned hospital.
You're not listening to me, she said, her voice rising. The worst thing you can possibly do now is search for others. The more of you together, the easier it will be for both the demons and the ECU to find you. Trust me when I tell you, the smartest thing to do right now is separate. At least until the water's clear and you know where you stand.
My hand slammed on the marble counter and surprised even me. We already know where we stand. We have to help those people. If we don't get them out, nobody is going to give a shit. I didn't mention that they were taken because of me, did I?
She's right. Those people need help. Luca said.
You know what's strange to me? All this time, the demons have never dared or knew how to get into the ECU. The dirts in there were protected better than anything I can come up with here. Yet the demons found them right after you guys were caught. I wonder why.
And her eyes met mine. Holy cow. It was like she knew. She knew about the green-eyed man and the kiss I'd given him to free us, which to him had translated into bring a bunch of demons into the facility.
It's not strange. The demons are evolving, Fallon said. They recognized Scarlet and Luca's magic. They were speaking.
This threw Elisa off.
Speaking?
Her voice broke. Yes, speaking. They've changed. I whispered, terrified of the memories.
So how did you escape?
Once again, everybody turned to me and the dragon around my left wrist.
It's that thing.
It turned into a sword made of lightning, Luca said, pointing at my hand.
It did. Elisa was smiling for some reason. She came closer to me and analyzed the dragon with narrowed eyes.
Looks pretty ordinary to me.
It can kill them. It killed them already. Three of them. Turned them to charcoal dust right in front of our eyes, I said half-heartedly. As much as I hated that thing, it was the reason why we were still alive and out of the demon's reach.
Sylvester Kane saw it all. He told us to run away, to find ways to kill them, because Adams would never let us go.
Not a drop of blood left in Elise's face. She went back to lean against the cabinets.
Show me.
What?
No.
Show her, Scarlet, Fallon said impatiently. I can't. I tried to do it last night while we were being chased, but it didn't work. So try again.
I squeezed my eyes shut and took in a deep breath. We need help, I said, turning to Elisa again. We don't know how to find their hideouts, and you do. All we need is to be pointed in the right direction.
To my surprise, she began to laugh. Look, I'm not going to lecture you about why you're being stupid. All I'm going to do is tell you that if you leave here together like this, the ECU will have you in cuffs before you can blink. If that's what you want, fine, go for it. But that is not the way to help anyone, not even yourselves.
So spell us, I said.
She'd done healing spells on me already. I was sure of it. Why not a hiding spell or a confusion spell for the road?
I intend to, Elisa said. But no spell I can put on you is going to keep them away for long. Do you understand me? They aren't going to stop until they get you in their hands again.
I didn't think she realized it, but with every word she spoke, she terrified me more and more.
Or maybe she did realize it, and that's why she was choosing those words.
So what do you suggest?
Axe asked, breathing heavily. He was mad, fists gathered by his side, his eyes red.
We just separate and leave? Forget any of this ever happened?
To be honest, I wished I could do that. I wished I could forget about the demons and the witches who were like us. Storm witches. That was what the green-eyed man had called me. I wondered if the others would hate the name as much as I did if I told them.
I suggest you separate for now. Leave in twos. Give it a few weeks before you get back together. Learn to shield your magic like Scarlet. And when your head's clear again, you can design a plan that will not lead you into the ECU's hands, or worse, the demons.
Or you can help us find the demons right now, and we can get on our way.
Trying to keep the anger off my words wasn't working. None of them knew what had really happened. None had any idea how the demons had found us. But I did. And the longer I stayed there doing nothing, the faster I was going to lose my mind.
But Elisa shook her head. I'm not going to find any demons anytime soon. The ECU is after me too, remember? I'm going to lay low for a while.
With a sigh, she rubbed her face furiously. I'm sorry, I really can't help you.
I was going to shout at her with everything I had when somebody beat me.
She could be right.
We all turned to Luca. Was he joking?
Didn't look like it.
If we separate into twos, we can use a few weeks to find others. What did we talk about when we decided to break into the ECU?
You broke into the ECU? Elisa said, her voice high-pitched as if she was about to have a heart attack. I flinched. Yeah. Now that I thought back to it, that was a pretty fucking dumb move.
We talked about how much stronger we'd be together,
Axe said, ignoring Elisa.
Exactly. If we all separate into...
Luca counted us with his eyes, and his math didn't add up.
If all of us go looking for others, when we get back together to plan, we'll be stronger. We'll have a better chance.
It's too risky, Axe said.
But his heart wasn't in the words.
He was staring at the floor, thinking about it, his eyes glazed over.
But it would be more efficient, Grover said. We could travel the whole country if we had to find others who are willing to fight.
Yes, that's awesome, Fallon cheered, a fake smile plastered on her face. Except we can't fight demons.
Scarlet can, Luca said, nodding at me.
While they spoke, a different kind of plan developed in my mind, one I was pretty sure none of them was going to like. It's why a vital part of said plan was to never tell them about it.
But we won't have a dragon in our hands, will we?
If we can find them at the store, let's go get them.
But we can't, Fallon said.
We don't need to. She'll be enough. Didn't you see what happened in the room? Grover said, grinning widely at me. She turned them into dust, Luca whispered. If there are enough of us to cause a distraction...
Yes, by inviting the demons to suck on our power, Fallon spit.
Exactly, said Axe. If we plan carefully, we can lure them out in such a position that it will be very easy for Scarlet to finish them all off.
That's assuming we can find them, Fallon said. I didn't take it personally. She had nothing against me. She was the only one to see how flawed this so-called plan of theirs was. For starters, as soon as the demons smelled us getting close, they'd be all over us. They'd suck us dry before we could lure them out. There was no telling how many of them were there, and going in blind was suicide. Experience told us as much when we went into the ECU with Oscar, the werewolf trader.
You can do it, right? You can make that thing work again, Grover asked me. I couldn't hide my flinch.
I don't know. I was going to try, that was for sure. It was part of my brand new, shiny plan.
She'll have time to train. If you can do it once, you can do it again, Elisa said.
You don't even know what I did. She hadn't been there, hadn't seen the sword or what it had done to the demons.
You did something that killed those things. That's good enough for me, she replied. It's a good plan, especially since it will make sure that we won't get caught by the ECU again. Tied up to beds, we won't be able to save anyone, Luca said.
I'm not so sure, Fallon whispered.
It's only a few weeks, 1 month, Axe said.
But he still sounded angry, as if he were still trying to convince himself that this was the right thing to do.
How would we even separate? Fallon asked. There's five of us.
Her math didn't add up either. I'd be on my own, I said reluctantly. Being a lying asshole was no fun, but this was a necessity. I'm used to it. I work better that way, and now that I know what to look for, I'll be much more efficient.
Grover and Axe would be together, and me and you, Luca said to Fallon with a smile.
It's a wise decision, Elisa nodded. I'm very sorry, guys, but the first pair needs to get going very soon. The best way to do this is to wait 3 hours before the next leaves. That way, the first will be too far away for any demon or ECU device to catch and trail back here.
We'll go first, Axe said with a nod.
My heart jumped for a reason I didn't understand. The thought of not seeing him again was making me a bit anxious. I looked at him, trying to figure out what the hell he was doing to me. But meeting his eyes only made me feel it more.
Are you absolutely sure that this is the right thing to do? Fallon asked, her eyes glistening with unshed tears.
I was. The reason why those demons had gotten into the ECU research facility was because of the kiss I gave to the green-eyed man. Somehow, in some way, he'd managed to bring them there to play his sick games, to test me, see how far I could stretch, how long before I figured out what the dragon could do. And I was the only one with a dragon on my hand, like Fallon said. I had the weapon that could kill those nasty creatures. Elisa was right. Or I just wanted to believe her. If I'd done it once, I could teach myself how to operate the dragon again, how to turn it into a sword. On my own, it was going to be much easier to find the power suckers and to sneak up on them, just like Elisa had when she'd freed us from that abandoned hospital. With a lightning sword, there would be no risks. The demons wouldn't come near me, and I'd chase them until all the others they took were set free. I would have thanked Elisa if I dared to tell any of them my real plan. She was the one who insisted we separate and brought this awesome idea to me, the only way to wash away my guilt.
"Your priority is the ECU," Elisa said, and when Axe opened his mouth, she raised her hand to shut him up. It was impossible to make sense of her. She looked so young, yet spoke and felt like she was older than all of us together.
"Doesn't matter what you think. If they catch you, they won't bother to keep you cuffed again. They'll kill you. Nobody is going to save the others then. So make that your top priority." She was right, of course.
"It's just a month," Luca said, nodding at himself.
Just a month. By then, hopefully, things would have changed drastically.
"What about Sienna?" Fallon asked, and my heart jumped again. We'd left the witch with Matthias, but I had no idea if that had been a good thing or a bad thing.
"I'll talk to Matthias," Axe said, and Luca shivered. "Axe, if he wasn't in on it. I know him. He had no idea, or he'd never have let us leave."
Axe cut him off. I believed him. Matthias could have been many things, but he was not a traitor against his own godson.
"I'll tell him to send her back where she came from."
If she wanted to go back, she wouldn't have run away. I felt bad for Sienna, but she was better off wherever she was raised, far away from this mess.
"I'll get Matthias to take her there himself," Axe said. "Where did she come from, Fal? Did she tell you?"
Fallon nodded, her face full of sadness. "Newton, Iowa. Her father owns a dairy farm."
"What if she already left?" Grover asked. "Could be. I'll give him a call as soon as we leave." "Use a disposable," Luca said, "and get out of the city as fast as you can."
"You too,"
Axe said with a nod. It was heartbreaking to hear them pretend they didn't care that they were leaving.
"I'll fix you up with a few weapons," Elisa said. She was suddenly in a great mood to see us leaving.
Axe turned to me.
"Right, so I think you should come with us."
My cheeks flushed. Too much energy in one place. Thank God Elisa spoke before I could.
"She'll be on her own," Axe said.
"Which suits me just fine. I was on my own before you found me," I reminded him. I'd been happy, drowning in blissful ignorance, never knowing how much I missed belonging. That was why I needed to do this myself. If something happened to them before I figured out how to free the others, I wouldn't be able to live with myself.
"Let's get you boys spelled and ready for the road," Elisa said, rubbing her hands together. The guys all wore Noah's clothes. It was a guess because they looked a size too big on Luca and Axe, but close to fitting on Grover. Like me, Fallon wore Elisa's clothes, though they fit her much better. My jeans were uncomfortable, but they'd do just fine for now. With any luck, by this time tomorrow, I'll be wearing my own clothes and holding my own weapons. It sucked to watch Axe and Grover go. They refused to say goodbye, merely a see you later, because goodbye was too definite. We were going to meet right where we first did, on the construction site where they'd found me, right before they got sucked dry by the demons I'd invited over there to fight. 1 month. It wasn't a lot, but hopefully it was going to be enough for me.
"What's on your mind?" Elisa whispered to me while we watched the others.
I'd said goodbye to both of them, and I'd given Luca and Fallon their space while I watched Axe. His eyes met mine every few seconds, too. I saw sadness in them. Maybe he was afraid he'd never see me again, too.
"Nothing," I said to Elisa, but the truth was, everything was on my mind. Going back to my apartment, finding a way to sneak in to get clothes, money, and weapons, and figuring out how to track the demons back to wherever they were hiding. And if I couldn't do that, the abandoned hospital would be the perfect place to start. They'd taken us there, hadn't they? Why wouldn't they take the others to the same place? After that, it was only a matter of figuring out what to do with the dragon. A sigh escaped my lips. It was going to be a long month. Bull, Elisa whispered, chuckling. I know you're hiding something. Even if I was, you wouldn't want to know. She was eager to kick us out, and with right. With every second we stayed there, we made her easier to find by the ECU. I wouldn't have wanted us there either. You're right. I don't, she said. Don't forget, guys. Straight out of the city. No stops. She waved at Grover and Axe, a bright smile on her face. Axe held my eyes for one last time before he stepped out the door and into the sunlight. Something tugged at my chest. I almost ran and jumped in his arms. Though I didn't know him very well, my body behaved like it knew his, like it had felt his touch before and it had bathed in his warmth and it demanded a replay. Instead, I just waved my hand at him weakly and hoped with all my heart that I'd get to see him again. Chapter 3. Axe and Grover were headed for San Francisco for 2 weeks. From there, they'd go to Washington. Luca and Fallon would first go to Texas, then Louisiana, while I, we decided, would go to Florida, then up in South Carolina, before coming back to Manhattan. Little did they know, I didn't plan to leave at all. Elisa was very prompt. As soon as 3 hours passed after Axe and Grover left, she reminded Luca and Fallon that they were next.
Be careful, Scarlet,
Luca warned me, while Elisa did her spells on them. You too. If something happens, run. Don't try to fight. Just run. Elisa had given them each a small gun, but that wasn't going to do much against the ECU or the demons.
Only if you do the same, Luca said.
The smile didn't reach his eyes. He stepped to the side when Elisa began to chant her spell on Fallon. That's when it occurred to me. Can I ask you something, Luca? How old are you? It was a strange question to ask, but an answer I needed to know.
20, Luca said. I look much older, I know.
My heart fell all the way to my heels. What about the rest?
Fallon just turned 21. Grover is still 19, if you can believe it.
Yes. That was really hard to believe. He looked so old, which just showed how difficult his life had been.
Axe turned 21 at the beginning of the year.
Damn it. I was older than all of them. But that didn't mean the green-eyed man was right. There was no freaking way that I was the first witch of our kind. There were others out there, so many others, and at least one of them was older than me. I just knew it. For now, I didn't give it much thought. With tears in her eyes, Fallon shook my hand, and Luca even hugged me, gave me a kiss on the cheek. It felt like we were real friends for a second. But it was just an illusion. I was no real friend to anyone. Real friends didn't lie to each other. I debated telling at least Luca what I planned, but I already knew he wasn't going to let me go. He'd never leave there without me. He'd insist on coming with me, and I couldn't have that. It was better this way. Or so I told myself. When they left, the goodbye almost had me in tears. Instead of letting them fall, I focused on my breathing and sat on Elisa's couch to pretend to watch TV while she went off in the kitchen and did whatever she was doing. Frozen for a while, my mind had completely blocked. I knew what I was going to do, but somehow, time had suspended, and it refused to pass by at its usual pace. The minutes stretched to eternity until every cell in my body was overflowing with panic and questions I was never going to find answers to, unless I did what I had to do.
"Here," Elise said, making me jump.
She was much closer than I'd realized. I hadn't even heard her sit on the couch beside me. She offered me a bowl of popcorn and a soda can. Like a robot, I took them and put them on my lap.
"I'm trying to figure out how that thing could have turned into a sword, but it's way beyond me," she said, opening her own soda.
"Can you walk me through what happened? I'd love to hear it, and we have time." It was true. I still had another hour to kill before leaving. "I'm not sure what happened. I found this weapon and..." But she cut me off.
"The best stories start from the very beginning," she said with a wink.
"I saw you fighting Finn's agents when they came for me. I do appreciate that, but I wish you hadn't bothered. Now, I almost feel like it's my fault that got you into this mess." I laughed dryly. Literally. The others were set on going into the ECU to help others like us, to set them free. But me? Shaking my head at myself, I laughed some more. "All I wanted to do was find you. Get you out so you could tell me everything." But now, that no longer seemed important. In my hand was a dragon that could kill demons, and it no longer mattered where they were from. It mattered that they died, and that we found a way to get the ECU to stop hunting us down. Maybe I was delusional for even thinking it, but ultimately, that's what I wanted.
"So what happened?" Elisa pushed, and I told her.
It was better than waiting for time to pass, anyway. I told her about Matthias, and about Oscar, and about the dragon. I told her about the research facility, how we'd gotten in, when we'd figure out that we'd been played, and everything that had happened inside. Well, almost everything. I didn't tell her about the fairy Jaren, or about the green-eyed man. The dragon was going to remain a secret to her for now, as well as my relationship to a psychopath who could walk through walls and bring a horde of demons to the ECU door.
"It's probably fairy," Elisa whispered when the story ended. She couldn't tear her eyes off my left hand.
To do something, I swallowed some soda and filled my mouth with popcorn.
"I'd inspect it, but I don't want to be thrown against the wall."
"No, no, don't touch it," I said, spilling pieces of popcorn in the process.
"Have you tried to get it off?"
There's a question I'd been hiding from myself. I hadn't tried to take the dragon off.
"Yes."
Don't know why I lied. Don't know why I didn't try to take it off yet, but I was pretty sure it had something to do with the fact that it could kill demons. For 2 years, I'd tried to find a way to end their lives. So far, the dragon hadn't activated again. It hadn't eaten my skin like I'd feared. All it had done was kill demons. For now, I was keeping it, right until the witches they kidnapped were free.
"What are you planning to do?" she asked me.
"Go to Florida." It seemed every time I spoke lately, I lied.
"No, I mean, what are you really planning to do?"
At least she wasn't buying it. "I'm really planning to go to Florida." Once the person knew they were being lied to, the lies flowed a bit easier.
"So you don't mind if I see you to the airport?" she grinned.
"I'm not going to the airport. I'm going to steal a car."
"Smart," Elisa said. "And then what?"
She was desperately trying to pry the words out of me, but I wasn't going to give up. "And then I'm going to find others like me, Elisa. I'm going to search every inch of those places until I get them. And I'm going to come back here." My own mind commended me. I was so good at this, it was scary.
"Suit yourself, Scarlet," Elisa said.
Laughing, she stood up.
"Suit yourself.
Can I use your bathroom? Then I'll be on my way." 20 more minutes.
I could lock myself in the bathroom until they were up because I didn't want to risk accidentally telling Elisa what I was really up to. Not that she'd care, but if she told anyone at all, word could get out fast, and the ECU had ears everywhere, especially around the lair after what happened last night.
Sure thing. Right after I'm done, Elisa said with a grin, and she danced her way to the bathroom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.